its glory in the form of heritage or something. One is, what are the personalities? Number two, what are the materials that are available or being made? Number three, what is the linkage and lineage for approach, affordability, accessibility, application and accomplishment? So there are the three things which we have to first to take into account before getting into anything to be practically proved. So this type of continental clash or disaster says that most of the things, they have been taken away, they have collapsed in continental disaster. Number two, the justification is cultural disaster due to invasions, cultural fusion, due to neomania, due to negligence, due to various other reasons, lack of the materials and personalities and the linkage and lineage that has been totally diluted or dilapidated. That is the second theory. And why we are not having these things? And there is a new concept. It is European appropriation and German appropriation theory. All these books have been taken by the Germans and now they are having in the research institutes, and all the new inventions are the basis of only the treatises which have been literally abducted or which has been forcefully confiscated from our land, that is being used for all of the new inventions. This is our chauvinistic theory, German attribution theory and European attribution theories are there. And apart from these type of attribution theories, by which they say that these things have been totally taken away, they are saying that obsoleteness theory. Most of the shakas, Vedic branches, they are obsolete. We cannot get those portions. They have been washed away by time, eroded by time. And most of the informations are available in the available treatises, but in a cryptic form. We have to decode it. We have to decipher and divulge the secret. So now, if you ask about the completeness or the consummate status of our scientific heritage in the form of personalities, linkage, lineage, traditional values, incorporation, inculcation, initiation, imbibition, etc. These six theories are coming. European appropriation, German appropriation, cryptic appropriation, obsoleteness in status, then continental disaster and cultural disaster. I am not here to say that these six points are fallacious and fictional. This may be true to a proper percentage, and attributing any loss or any deficiency to these factors instead of trying to make the consummate status being properly made, that is a lame excuse, and that type of lame excuse and fragile justifications that will further weaken the system. How Europeans they can understand things if there are three problems? One is the lingual base. The language is entirely different. Even people like Monier Williams, Oldenburg, Gottlieb, Theodore Goldstucker, A.B. Keith, E.B. Cowell, and more various other people like even Frederick Max Muller, they translated lot of books. So even lingual base is not a problem. What about your other two issues like decodification, how you can decodify, how you can just demystify those things, how we can understand the inner messages, how these people can do, even Indians are struggling for decodification, how these people they can do that. Third is disciplining difficulty for the Westerners. The acharas, the principles of life that have been restricted in the shastras, the treatises for getting the real meaning, the shastras they have enumerated innumerable ways of disciplines of life without which the person cannot arrive at the real meaning. Only peripheral meaning, prosaic meaning, apparent meaning, instrumental meaning can be understood by people. Understanding the intensive, unfathomable, abysmal core of the source of wisdom is not possible for a non-disciplinary and non-disciplining person. So how these Westerners, just by mastering the linguistic status by means of phonology, phonomorphology, orthography, semantics, syntax, etymology, lexicography, etc., how they can get into the deeper meanings? These things are unimaginable. So we have to filter the problems within ourselves and integrate the scientific study. Then we have to go for the international platform, is my humble opinion. And then coming to the real point, if you want to study about your heritage, we want to understand four things. What is the root of your heritage? And what are the volumes of your heritage available? What is the value of the volumes of the heritage? What is the viability of incorporation of the volumes of the volumes of your heritage? So root, second is the volume, third is the value, fourth thing is the viability. Coming to root, there are major principles which are hindrances. Number one, everything is got by revelation. According to our treatises, nobody says that I have just learnt and I have just thought in solitude and I have produced these things. Each and everybody, they adhere to three things. One is acharya, that is a blessing from his spiritual or preceptorial master. Number two, austerity and penance, tap here. Third thing is contemplation. Fourth thing is daya or merciful shower of God. These four components are there in all the treatises of our Vedic, post-Vedic literatures. Shruti, Smriti, Itihasa, Purana, Dharma Shastra, Mimamsa, whatever it may be, all Shastric traditions, they attribute to preceptorial guidance and blessing, the blissful blessing or the benedictory shower of the God. Third thing, penance and austerity, a strong willful contemplation for getting the knowledge success. So these things are the tools on the basis of which they have understood. And strong practice of the disciplines in the form of achara, they mentioned. So how to get these things? Number one. Number two, we are having lot of issues. We need a bilateral expansion. The society is expanding. The issues are expanding. Knowledge pursuit is also expanding in terms of science and technology. But shastras are stagnant. Can you form a new Veda? Can you form a new shastra? That's what I told yesterday in Delhi conference. Harsha parampara, shastra parampara, both have become obsolete. So what we have to say, there are only two points. That it is stagnant, due to which it is incomplete. Number two, it is stagnant, but it still it is complete. So we have to put into the stagnated stages, the status of completion or conservation on universality for the Vedic wisdom. They have written books before thousands of years. Now the time is different, new issues are emerging. How we can bother about, or how we can refrain from bothering about all of these issues where there is unilateral expansion, but the shastras are put into stagnation? Certainly it should be answered. There are four theories. One is completion theory. Second is inspiration theory. Third thing is manifestation theory. Fourth thing is lead theory. What is complete theory? Complete theory is that the shastras are complete. New things may come now, but these new things have their older basis. The shastras, they deal with the basic components, and anything that has to occur, irrespective of place, time, or contextual situations, everything will be on the basis of the immutable system or the framework. For example, even if you get hundreds of diseases, they must be constituted within this Pitta, Vata, and Sleshma. And whatever new particles that you invent, they must be within the five bhutas, the primordial elements. So they give in this completion theory that in spite of the various expansions and elucidations and multidimensional manifestations of the society, still the formal base, the primordial structure of these global components, certainly it is the same and it is immutable. So Vedas deals with the primordial status, due to which whatever you may do newly, the new thing may be novelty in dimension manifestation, but that will have a old grandfather base on the foundation of which these things are being erected and installed. That's completion theory. Second thing is inspiration theory. Shastras are not only information tools, but they are also inspiration tools. They can give knowledge and they can give you that urge, they can give you that power to go beyond the knowledge given in the book. That is the greatness of shastras. Shastras, they can give you the knowledge within the book. They also supply you some sort of internal tools like cognitive drilling, deeper contemplation, multifaceted analysis, contemplative or cogitative vision, pensive subjection, all of these various experiences of the inner mind, these things come from the shastras. So shastras give you the materials, also give you additional tools for getting into other materials. That is inspiration source. Third thing is manifestation. As per the arithmetology or terminology, specialized terminology of the shastras will have hundreds of meanings for the same term, which will emerge by three circumstances. One is contextual emergence, second thing is temporal emergence, third thing is dimensional emergence. For example, if you read the same book before 100 years, whatever that is suitable to that time, it will be revealed. After 100 years, on a different time frame, if it is taken and reanalyzed, it will reveal something that is contemporary. That is temporal suitability or temporal compatibility of shastras. And number two, it is dimensional compatibility. In one dimension you are seeing the shastra. If there is any urge for finding out some other dimension, that urge will facilitate you to understand that dimension. So the context, the time, and the dimensions and depths, based on the necessities, when the same shastras are re-evaluated, they can be redefined, they can refine any circumstances. It is one of the manifestation theory of shastras. Fourth is the lead theory. What is lead theory? The shastras will give you some enthusiasm, and you have to develop further books. If you are not developing, that is your mistake.